The following special event is brought to you by Ash Brokerage, the practice enhancement company.
Welcome to Steve Savant's fourth annual tribute to Halloween entitled The Coroner. We'll perform autopsies on unplaced cases from the files of the declined, the postponed, and the heavily rated. Our expose on life insurance underwriting to usher in the substandard season. And throughout the week, we'll be giving away our underwriting guide of the top 10 commonly seen conditions. And on today's show, how selecting the right carrier can make all the difference. Part 4 of this week's series on impaired risk underwriting. Hi everyone, I'm Steve Savant, syndicated financial columnist and contributing author to Backroom Technician and Innsmark. Let's get down to business. Over half of all Americans who own life insurance are in the wrong rate class and overpaying for coverage. Now's the time to secure a second opinion. And one of the biggest reasons to get a second opinion is because there are certain impairments that are perfect for certain carriers. There's a carrier that's coming to mind. I would never send them a diabetic case because they're really not good at diabetes. So I never really think about them. They never cross my mind. But certain carriers are really benevolent towards diabetes, whether it's diabetes 1, diabetes 2, or it's insulin, or it's diet controlled, whether it's adult onset. All those things matter, and certain carriers really look at diabetes different. So I always want to make sure I'm using the right carrier with the right impairment. Now, when I'm looking at this, remember, I have product issues too, because remember, some people's products are less expensive. If I get a premium that's actually very competitive and the underwriter has a table shaving program and the impairment that we're talking about, like in my case, a diabetic, this could be huge because I could match up the premium with the table shaving program with the right carrier, and I could really get a fantastic offer and really save my client a lot of money. So I'm always looking at the premium first. Where am I at the big picture? So I might look at, if I'm looking at term, I'm going to be looking at maybe 20-year term, or if I'm looking at a permanent policy, I might be looking at GUL, Guaranteed Universal Life, from an indemnification point of view, just to kind of get me going and see where the actual premium lays out. I might be using other products. Of course, I could be using indexing and current assumption UL, but I'm really looking to see what my premium status is. And once I find that out, I'm gonna look at standard plus and standard, because even if I have a rated case, I'm still gonna be looking at these two platforms, these two mortality chassis. And I wanna make sure, what do I have at plus and standard? And remember, sometimes when I'm within the company's retention, I might be able to actually negotiate up standard plus. So to me, it's really important. Now, when we're talking about this, oddly enough, one big component in my view is the ability to know who issues at the last age. And I'm looking at this age last birthday guidelines, and it shows a handful of carriers that actually really price it at the last age, not the current age or what's closest age, but what is their last birthday back. And this thing can go back 6 months, especially if you're looking at 1035 exchanges or single deposits. This is a huge issue because this could be the difference. Again, I'm looking at the first slide I showed you. Hey, I'm looking at, should I do standard plus? Does the carrier offer it? Or can I get standard to be able to get my chassis as most efficient as I can? The second thing is can I get the age? Can I catch age? So I'm going to be looking at carriers that do age last birthday, and are they in the impaired risk area? And on top of that, are they into table shaving or lifestyle credits? To me, that's a real big issue. And what I do that is I like to look at the numbers, because I think there's some really good numbers here when I'm looking at EBICS. This is EBICS quote. I'm comparing standard plus non-smoker and the regular standard amount. And again, we're looking at about 10 to 12 companies here, carriers, and look at the difference between first place and the 10th place position. Again, to price this out and to really test the market, you're looking at a difference between 15 and 20%, anywhere from the first position to the 10th position. That's a big chunk of premium. So I want to make sure I have the best possible idea. First, I look at product. So I'm looking at my product grid. And when I look at that product grid, I'm going to look at which one of these companies are benevolent in underwriting and are known for table shaving, lifestyle credits, and maybe even specifically in that impairment, do they actually own that impairment? In other words, i.e., they're really benevolent towards the client. Another thing I want to look for when I'm looking at this is I'm looking at anomalies in our market, and here's a big one. And normally I don't like to really focus on one carrier, but this specific carrier has a really great idea. They have a rated case. Let's say you have a rated case, and that rated case is, let's say, table B. and you can't get it down any lower. That was the best you could do. And that table B, instead of the client dying at the 2001 CSO at age 81, they show the client dying at 73. So they predict that based on actuarial tables. When they do that, what happens if the client decides he lives past that age? So every year that he lives past his mortality expectation based on his rating, he actually will then be able to get the substandard charges credited back to his account. This is, in this specific carrier, they call it the return of substandard charges option. This option is great. It works for anywhere from ages 0 to age 80. It goes from a substandard rating. It can go for 20 years at issue ages 0 to 70 and 15 years for issue ages 71 to 80. The minimum face amount is the same for as the base policy. And this is where I like it, because what happens if your client lives? All that substandard charge he may have paid over 10 to 15 years, all that is credited back to his cash values. This to me is really good actuarial underwriting, because they're really saying, wow, you did beat the tables, and now we're going to give you a reward and credit it back, all those substandard charges back to your cash values. That's a great deal. Back in the day, life insurance professionals were called field underwriters. Then carriers trained their field force in the basics of life insurance underwriting. Today, the insurance industry doesn't educate their agent population as they once did. But now you can have a quick synopsis of the top 10 commonly seen conditions at your fingertips, so you can illustrate a reasonable rate class for your prospects. Just email me for your copy of the top 10 commonly seen conditions at steve.savant@ashbrokerage.com. It's free from Ash Brokerage, the practice enhancement company. Well, we're talking about matching up the right carrier with the right client and the right impairment. And nowhere is this more important than when you're dealing with seniors, especially in the 70s and 80s. And you want to match up the right carrier for this age group. And it's really changed over the years. But before we do that, I want to walk you through some of the basics here. When we're talking about matching up the right client, remember, behind every carrier, especially if we're outside their retention, we may be in reinsurance pools. And I want to find out, there are reinsurance pools that seem, at least to me, have the appearance of being much more benevolent than others that they compete against. And when I'm looking at it, remember, there's several of them. There's Lincoln Re, there's Swiss Re, there's Cologne, and there's Gen Re, just to name a few. So I'm going to be looking at them, and remember, they have to agree with the carrier whether they're going to extend lifestyle credits or use table shaving programs. But another area that I like to look at is the age. If I'm going to go ahead and write in the senior market, how high up can I go? Well, right now we're issuing to age 90 on a lot of these carriers, depending upon the impairment, again, it depends upon how big the table is, but they'll issue actually all the way up to age 90. Now, this is staggering when you think about it, because some of our contracts, the maturity dates are of these contracts run between 100 and 120, and we're already now issuing all the way up to age 90. The impact of the mortality revolution has really changed the way we think about things. When I came into the business, we were on the 1958 CSO system. Then we went to the 1980, now we're on the 2001, and the Society of Actuaries just published their 2008 VBT relative risk tables, which just keeps showing the extension of life. And in fact, when you think about it, Willard Scott says happy birthday to a handful of Americans who turn 100 every day. And we now have 23 people that are what we call super centurion teenagers. There are 113 all the way up to 119. It's amazing. So when we're looking at age 90, even though this looks to be quite old to be issuing a contract, think about it. We've graduated past 80, past 85, and a majority of these carriers now are issuing at age 90. Now, one of the big things about issuing at age 90, when you're up into the 80s and 90s, you're going to have to do more than just look at this chart. You're going to have to look at a mature assessment, because we don't know the condition, the mental capacity of our client. So I'm going to be looking at the carriers that are going to be looking at their assessment, their mature assessment guidelines, so I can make sure the client understands what they're getting and that it's appropriate insurance for them. I have to go through this battery. Now, there's a handful of these carriers. There's about 12 that are involved in this. And I always, if I look at the carrier list and I see table shaving and they issue to age 90 and I look at their mature assessment protocols, I'm going to look at that and try to match that up to see if I can make that work for my client. Remember, the geriatric market is very, very narrow in the people that really plan it well. And the product pricing is another issue, because again, before I start on this, I always want to look at my standard boilerplate first and see what those numbers are, and then identify lifestyle credit carriers, table shaving carriers, carriers that have good mature assessment guidelines, And of course, how old do they go? Do they go all the way up to age 90? And do they have any limitations on face amount? Well, remember, over half of all Americans who own life insurance are in the wrong rate class and overpaying for coverage. Now's the time to secure a second opinion. Well, that's all the time we have for today. Remember, before moving forward with any of the ideas on our show, always consult your tax advisor, legal counsel, or your broker-dealer compliance officer. Missed an episode? Just hop out to our video archives. And remember, you could be wiser as an educated advisor. I'm Steve Savant. We'll see you tomorrow. Today was part 3 of our 5-part series on life insurance underwriting. To order your free copy of the top 10 commonly seen conditions, just go to downtobusiness.ashbrokerage.com. And remember, over half of all Americans who own life insurance are in the wrong rate class and are overpaying for coverage. Now is the time to secure a second opinion with the largest in-house underwriting staff in the brokerage community. So don't forget to follow me on Twitter, Facebook, LinkedIn, or just email me at steve.savant@ashbrokerage.com. And remember, you could be wiser as an Ash Brokerage advisor. Happy Halloween, everyone.